thank you for all the people that gave their lives that we could be here and appreciate this day. We love you and all of them that's on the road traveling. We pray that they'll come back home safe and to us. Give you the praise in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
If it's not, we're going to have to do surgery. So they want us to agree this morning
that the medicine is working. And they don't have to go in and do that surgery, because she can lose that eye. So I want us to pray this morning. So I'm sorry I told you to sit down, so stand back. Also, we want to remember Mason Raleigh. They found out this week he's 4 years old. And he has leukemia. And so I want us to pray for that family. Also, we still remember Pam and Wes's grandson, Jackson, and ask the Lord to strengthen him through this time, the treatments that he's going through. And I want God to just do a miraculous work in those children. And he can do it, can't he?
Yes.
He can.
Yes.
So we got a lot of sick this morning, a lot of people that just need a touch from God. So let's pray for these men this morning and ask the Lord to touch and to bring healing to them today. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come this morning and we're believing God for healing for these this morning. For Michael this morning, Lord, I ask you, Father, to bring healing to his body, God. The fever, Lord, and all that's going on, Lord, we're asking, Father, that you, Lord, will minister healing to him this morning, Lord. Over there in the house, God, and you'll just show up on the scene, Father, in the name of Jesus. We pray this morning for Thelma Walker this morning. We pray, God, that as they go and take her to the ER this morning, that this is going to work, this medicine, Lord, that they're not going to have to do surgery, and this is going to work, God. We believe today. We're agreeing together, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We pray, God, that for Mason this morning, with leukemia this morning, Lord, the news that that family got this week, we ask God that you will touch that baby, touch Jackson, God, as he's going through these treatments. God, we're believing, Lord, miracles in this place. We believe, God, that you're going to touch and move and heal by the name of Jesus. Above all other names, your name, Lord, Jesus. When we call out your name, Jesus, things happen, Lord. And we pray this morning, God, that you will bring healing to these. In the name of Jesus, amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. You can sit down for a minute, then we're going to worship. There'll be no children's church today. Heather's not here, so there'll be no children's church. And Wednesday night, we're going to have a very special guest, and you need to be here. And if you don't know him, he's a great man of God. Ernest Brock's going to be preaching for us. So don't forget to be here Wednesday night and hear the word of the Lord. Also, today, we're going to have a privilege of baptizing Michael this morning and putting him under that water and seeing what the Lord is doing in his life. I'm telling you, God's doing a new thing in Michael. And I want to be there and encourage him and lift his hands up, and I want you to do the same. And I'm telling you, God's doing some great and mighty things in him. So today we're going to see a lot of things happen around here, I believe. Also, this coming Saturday, I think I'm wrong. I think it's 2 weeks. It's Kristen's shower. It's June the 10th. Uh-huh. It's a week from Saturday. And she's having a girl. This is Debbie and Greg Walker's daughter. And so she's having a baby shower. And she has a food sign-up sheet in the foyer there on there. And I need you to go by there and see something that you can help them out with and fix. I would really appreciate it. So don't forget that. That's a week from Saturday at 2 o'clock. So remember that. Wendy, you got some announcements?
There will be no youth service tonight because we've got a lot of people out of town. And also, beginning tomorrow, we'll start our fast. And we'll be doing it for 21 days. The first week will be no cough, and this is for the youth group, but if any of you older ones want to participate, it's going to begin tomorrow, May the 29th, and it'll go through June the 4th, be no cough. And I'll let you know next week what we'll be fasting, but that begins tomorrow, so don't forget that.
Also, Vacation Bible School's coming up. That is unreal. Absolutely. Last night, I said, Lord, all these vacation Bible schools starting. So it's just flew by here. But July the 10th through the 14th, Tracy will be having vacation Bible school here. And she has a sign-up sheet out in the foyer for those that want to volunteer their time. And so you need to go by there and sign up on that so you can help her. And it will be from 5 to 8 p.m., the Vacation Bible School this year. So the name of it is The Armor of God. And also, Teresa Johnson is going to be taking up t-shirt orders for her, and it's $10. So make sure you see Teresa and get your t-shirt for Vacation Bible School. So right now, we're going to worship as the brothers come to take our tithes and offerings this morning. Let's worship in our giving. Let's stand and do our declaration. As we bring in today's tithes, offerings, and over and above giving, we are believing the Lord for a supernatural release of God's favor over every area of our lives. Jobs and better jobs, checks in the mail, inheritances, secure investments, scholarships, creative ideas, finding money, healing for our spirit, soul, and body, deliverance to the captive, salvation to the lost, and an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. We are blessed and we will be a blessing to others in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Our scripture for today, Matthew 7:7 says, ask, and it shall be given unto you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it will be opened unto you. And everyone that asketh, receiveth. Everyone that seeketh, findeth. And everyone that knocketh, it shall be opened unto you. If you need something from God, ask. If you need something from God, seek.
Yeah.
You ask, it will be opened unto you. And Matthew 5:6, it says, blessed is he that hungers and thirsts after righteousness, for they shall be filled. If you hunger and thirst after righteousness, you shall be filled. You've got to want it. If you want it, you look for it, you seek it, you'll find it. He's got it for you. My brother wanted me to thank everybody that had prayed for him. His life passed through, and his last option, cancer-free. Thank you. so many of our brothers and sisters that are sick, Lord, that need your help, Lord, that needs, they need healing, Lord. God, you bring those before you right now, Father. That you would touch them, and you would help them, God, and you would strengthen them, Father. That you would drive away cancer, Lord, and you would heal the flu and the pneumonia, Lord, that you would just lift them up, God, and you would bring them before them, Father. Touch each and every request that we put forth here today, Father, every spoken request, every unspoken request, Lord. Move along, God, in a mighty, mighty way. Now we claim the stripes that Jesus took upon his back for his healings, Lord. God, we ask you, Lord, God, that you would bless our nation, Lord. God, that you would just touch, God, that you would help us, Lord. You would bring us back together, Father, under Jesus, Lord. We speak the name of Jesus over every problem in our community, Lord. God, we speak blessings over coming down the days, Lord. God, we ask that you would move upon your church, upon your people, Father. Bless each and every one here today, Father. God, bless this offering we're about to receive. Touch everyone here, Father. Give you our praise. We thank you, Father, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We need your mercy. And your grace. If it hadn't been for that, I don't know where we'd be today. I know where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord. And I'm so glad that we can be in His presence. And it creates that atmosphere of whatever you need in your life. If we get in His presence and we're sincere about it, He'll take care of it. I'm telling you, when I was laid up, we were visiting with some friends this week. They got to talking about a situation that preacher friend, we knew him, but he decided he didn't need to go to church. Didn't need that kind of atmosphere, I guess. But he wanted his girls to not feel like they wouldn't go to church, so about 2 o'clock on Sunday, they all come to his house and have a little meeting, I guess, and said he still wanted to pay their tithes. I'm guessing where that went, but anyway, we got to talking about how important it is to come together, be together as a group of people, as a family. You know, that matters. It's so good when families can get together and visit and fellowship. And I know Daddy, he loves it. He wants some of us there all the time. And bless his heart, we do the best. She's doing what she can, and he's got to realize that. But anyway, but when we come together in a church, and it's our family, and we get to sing in the praises of the Lord, and we get to hear His word, and we're truly gathered in this night, He'll be there, and whatever you need in your life, call for the elders of the church, is what the Bible says. Anoint you, and the prayer of faith will save the sick and raise you up. I'm all about it.
served or is serving, but if you've worn this country's uniform, would you stand up this morning? You stand up, please. We'd love to salute you and honor you, ladies and gentlemen.
Cutting all those plants down and got his truck down there impounded, took all his guns away from him. And I called him up, and big old deep voice on the other end, you know, he's telling me all about it. I got ready to hang up. He said, hey, Pat. I said, yeah. He said, I might need to be a character witness for him.
Served our nation to help
found it and built it and keep it safe. We're reading in your book about another generation who went through much the same thing. We understand that we owe them honor. And God, forgive us for the dishonor that has spread so widespread and so violently in our society today. Forgive us and help us and heal us and help us here at the Common Pentecostal Church to be a people of honor. We give honor, we show honor, we expect to receive honor, but we've got to know that there's no receiving honor unless we plant that crop. Help us to honor one another, and help us to honor those who lead the way, and honor those who have fought, and help us to honor our parents and one another, and our children, and our brothers and sisters, that we might bring glory to your great name in this great land that you provided for us to live in Jesus' name. And everybody say it.
Amen.
Now this scripture, I think, is pretty straightforward. I don't have this thought. If a people will follow God, then they'll have the blessings of God. And anybody that talks about, well, it's just complicated. It's a complicated situation. You better watch that terminology. That's a pretty good indication that somebody's really trying to hide something or deceive you or control you or do something to just muddy the water so that you don't know what's going on. This is plain and simple. Here is a people who owe their deliverance to God, and God laid out his word, and he laid out his plan, and he said, if you'll follow this, you'll remain free people, and you'll remain blessed people, and you'll bring glory to my name. That's simple. Now, our concern is, this is the Old Testament. A lot of folks flip out when you start talking about the Old Testament. So our question is this portion of Scripture, is it applicable, and is it authoritative in our lives and to our generation? I won't tell you this. I believe it is. The Old Testament, after all, was the only Scripture that Jesus had when he opened the Scripture to describe to his disciples the plan of his Father and his place as the Messiah in his Father's plan. It's the only Scripture that Paul and those fellows had. They wrote the rest of it. So it is authoritative. It is applicable. And ultimately, we have to understand that this whole book, you can't just pick and choose out of this. This whole book judges us. We don't judge it. That's pretty plain, too. That's all hard to get a hold of. Some professed Christians and writers have said that the God you meet in the Old Testament is so drastically different from the God that you encounter in the New Testament. It has to be two different gods. Well, I'm here to tell you this morning that I believe that the same God we read about in Genesis 1 and 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, is the same God we read about in Revelation 22, a pure river of life flowing from beneath the throne of God. I accept what the Apostle Paul said in 2 Timothy 3, that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction. That means the Old Testament is applicable and it is authoritative. But there's a difference in authority and claim. Let's just give us a little scenario going here, a hypothetical. If I'm downtown and all of a sudden I hear somebody shouting, get on your knees, get on the ground, get down, do it now. I turn around and look, and here is obviously a police officer with his uniform on and his badge on his chest and his Glock slipped right up between somebody's eyeballs. I recognize he's a person of authority. He or she is a person of authority. I recognize that what they say has meaning and consequence, but he's not looking at me. He's looking at some miscreant, and I'm over here on the sideline. He's a person of authority, but in this case, it is not applicable at that place. His demands have no claim on me at that moment. Why would I pick out something like that? Because there are things in the Bible like that. Specifically, in Leviticus chapter 14, chapter 19, chapter 23, and chapter 25, we read basically the same phrase, when you That's authority. It is applicable, but it's not talking to me. It's not talking to you. It's talking about that band of slaves that was released from Egypt, and they're making their way toward the promised land. And God says, now this doesn't count right now even for you, but when you come into that land, here's the way I want you to live. Here's some instructions for you. That's not the end of that, because in Deuteronomy chapter 12, the Lord spells out a situation. When you get into that land, you're going to begin to flourish, and you're going to grow, and you're going to be productive, and you're going to find that you're going to spread out from that land. I'm taking you to the promised land, but as a blessing of God is on you, you're going to spread out to other nations. You will find yourself in places when it comes time for the regular feast back in Jerusalem and the sacrifices, which I've commanded that you attend, you're going to find it's too far to go. Here's what you do. And he spells out what they're to do in that foreign land to continue to honor God. So there's some things that are authoritative and they're applicable. They're just not necessarily applicable to me in this particular moment. So the question arises, well, why? Why don't we even invest our time in studying these things and learn about them? And I tell you, it's because God's character is revealed in those things.
Yes.
And God's character does not change. Situations change. Dispensations change. Culture changes. Geographic locations change. Kingdoms change. Kings change. Some of them run one day down the next. All kinds of things change. But I want to tell you about one that the writer of Hebrews said is the same yesterday.
Makes it so important for us today because we're surrounded
about the worshipers. That devil doesn't care how many babies you abort. That devil doesn't care what kind of immorality you get into. He doesn't care what you shoot in your veins or swallow. That devil doesn't care anything about what you get eaten up with cirrhosis of the liver or some kind of venereal disease or nothing. He'll stand around and laugh at you while you're dying. But we're not talking about that devil.
Yeah.
Genesis 7, come into the ark, he said to Noah, for thee have I seen righteous in this generation. He's still looking for those who will live right.
Yes.
Who will not try to explain away his word. Who will not take the side of impurity and immorality. But say, this is God's word, and I'm going to stand on God's word.
Yes.
And when the storm comes, he will have to pay the way that you will ride over the storm. Hallelujah. Everybody else is swept away with the trash. But if you embrace this word and this God, you're going to ride safe on the other side. Are you with me? In Exodus 19, Moses went up, was called of the Lord up into the mountains, and the Lord said, you saw what I did to the Egyptians and how I bare you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. If you will obey my voice, I'll make you a peculiar treasure and a kingdom, a priest.
Yeah.
This world, all may turn into beggars and paupers. They have no clothes, no shoes, no money, no nothing, no reputation, be totally morally, spiritually, physically bankrupt. But our God said that he has planned for us, if we follow him, is to prosper us to the point that we'll be a kingdom, a priest, hallelujah, a nation, a priest, decked in the jewels of heaven, be decked in the robes of glory. We get to the final book of the Bible, chapter 7 of Revelation. He said, these are they that came through great tribulation and serving day and night in his temple. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun or the heat light on them, for the Lamb in the midst will feed them, and he'll lead them by fountains of living water, and he'll wipe away the tears. Can you imagine that? That our God, this God, that we bow down to, this God, that made provision for our redemption and our deliverance and our safety, this God, if we will listen and follow and seek after him, will wipe every tear away. There will be no reason for sorrow. No reason for pain. I'm trying to talk to you about this God. It's true, he's a judge, this God. It's true, he's a savior. This God is a deliverer, a redeemer. This God is a provider. He is a father. He is a friend. He is the king of kings, this God.
Yeah.
That's the greatest contrast, I think, between Islam and the Bible, the God of the Bible. Islamic scholar, they instruct, but I understand. And everything about Islam, it changes in every moment. Changes every moment. The danger that he's always creating everything new. That's what they say about Allah. The danger of that is what I did 5 minutes ago to bring pleasure to him now makes him angry. What I did yesterday to honor him now brings him great shame, because everything is being recreated in every moment. A certain action or an attitude that was acceptable just a moment ago is suddenly unacceptable. But this God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He was holy yesterday. He's holy now. He will be holy tomorrow. This God that we serve was merciful yesterday. He's merciful now, and he's going to be merciful tomorrow. This something like 40 gods and goddesses, religious systems mentioned in the Bible. Molech and Baal and Chemosh and Diana of Ephesians and all the rest. And for the most part, they cared nothing about their worshipers. One of their letters, a man wrote, although I'm certainly looking for help, nobody takes me by the hand. When I weep, they do not come to my side. I utter laments, but no one hears. I'm troubled, I'm overwhelmed. I cannot see whether I've committed sin or I'm doing good. That's the way of the world. That's the condition that millions of people are in today. They don't know if they're doing good or sin. That's Saul Alinsky's problem, you know. He just tore everything down raised, is that tear down, confuse the situation. Let me remind you that Saul Alinsky dedicated his book to Lucifer, the first rebel, and said that he won his own kingdom. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something, folks. You can't embrace the philosophy of this world. You can't embrace the disrespect and the endless struggle. And you can't hold on to that stuff. It is a culture of death. It is a culture of destruction. He wrote that all altruism, all self-giving, is just an American fairy story. In other words, people like Corrie ten Boom, Oscar Schindler, and saved so many people from the Nazis, all of those people were motivated just by some kind of a personal reward, or the thought of some kind of a personal reward. Men like Chris Kyle, the deacon's boy that endured 6 explosions and 2 gunshot wounds and 4 deployments to Iraq, continued defending America and doing what he could to defend America. All of that was just because he had some kind of perverted bloodlust. Saul Alinsky's doctrine that so many based their political activities on, he taught that the organ donor and the doctor and the medical personnel that fight Ebola and the first response teams and rush off to disaster, all of this is just some kind of American fairy tale that people won't glory. And the Christians who refuse to kneel down to that mess, and they'll lose their head if they don't kneel down, they stand up. But Saul Alinsky's doctrine was that they just self-centered and looking for glory. I want you to know something. I know as well as anybody in this place this morning that there's nothing more deceitful than the human heart. I've worked with people all my adult life. I understand that there's nothing on God's green earth that is sorrier than a sorry human being. I've been there. I got the call. I went running across town. I walked into that little house and here these two college-educated parents of this beautiful little family, and the police were there, and they said, "We're taking him in," and he's crying and he's carrying on. Oh, let me speak to Patton Franks. Let me speak. And that old boy said to him, "I see that window. You better not go out that window." I'm standing around there, my eyes about the size of a silver dollar. I didn't know if I was going to go in that room with that guy or not. We got in that room. Of course, he handcuffed him. We put him in there. Put him in that room. I'm standing there listening to this horrible story. Big tears are coming down his face. He raped his own 4-year-old daughter. I was standing at the altar there one Sunday morning. This lady, their family, had at one point been a part of our church. She came forward and just fell on my shoulder and my ear. And I couldn't understand a thing she was saying. She was mumbling, crying. After church, I got her off to the side. And what's going on? She named her husband and said, he is a sexual abuser. I called the police department. I thought she flipped out. I knew that guy. He looked like a pillar in the community. Called him back, preacher. It's true. There's an active investigation. They had a little deaf mute foster child in their home. He went to pick her up and stopped at a motel overnight and sodomized that little girl. I know there's nothing any sorrier than a human being. I looked the embezzlers in the face who stole the money right out of the church treasury.
Come on.
Leaving us broke, couldn't pay the bills, and found out later, when it was too late to do anything about it, anything over a $20 bill went to cotton. No wonder he won't put carpet in my house. No wonder he won't haul me around that way. telling you folks, this will change people's lives. This will change their hearts. This will set you free. It'll set you free. I remember Bert Blaine did the same when he got back to San Francisco after being over there in the South Pacific. He got another vision, had a vision of that rising sun flying over this great country. He said, I turned around, went back, and fought that enemy all over again. We've got to have that kind of determination when it comes to this enemy of ours. We're dealing with a real enemy. We're dealing with Antichrist. The spirit of Antichrist is in the world. We've got to know that. More so than anybody else in this community. You and I have to understand, we can't play around with this junk. We have got to decide, and the sooner the better, that we're either on his side, or we're going to chase that converted mess out there now. You thank God, the God that set you free. You think he's going to smile when you stick that stuff in your veins? Take another swallow of that dope? No, our God, this God, he grieves when we hurt ourselves. He grieves when we make those bad decisions. There is a system that rejoices over your destruction. Oh, my Father God, in Jesus' name. If there are people here this morning who are finding that battle, and they're torn between that culture of the world or this Savior of the world, give them whatever it is they need right now to make the right decision. Don't let them follow that Antichrist anymore. Give them the power to say no to that and yes to the Lord Jesus. We sense your presence. We know you want to do something in us. We know you want to do something in our world. And we pray for our world. And we pray for Jerusalem. And we pray for our nation. Can you believe it? There's so many. It seems like there's so many criminally genius minds. I think about this anarchy in the streets. You may have seen that mother up there. Was it Baltimore or Boston? She was out there on the sidewalk and had all that protest, and she spotted her teenage boy out there throwing stuff to police. You see, how many of you remember that video? Did you see that video? She slapped her knot on his head. It's one thing to be dealing with police in riot gear, another thing to be dealing with a man's law. She slapped a knot. That's the problem in our country. Parents have abdicated their position.
Yes, yes, right.
They've abdicated the place of authority.
Yeah.
We have to be a people of honor. We give honor. We're not anarchists. We keep the law because we believe in the law, because our God is the great lawgiver. Man, to be personal, there's a law that I'm to abide by. There's some things that I'm to abide by. I can't have the life he promises. I can't have the freedom he promises unless I'm willing to follow his law. We're going to worship this morning. If you need prayer, this altar's open to you. If you'd like to come give your heart to Jesus, this altar's open to you. Would you stand with me this morning and let's celebrate our real freedom, and that is freedom from sin.
I give myself away. So you can use me. I give myself away. Oh, man. praying with him. All of those that come to see him get baptized today, we're glad that you're here. And we're excited about what God has done in Michael's life.
Yes.
And I mean, he has tremendously changed him. If you want to go up on the balcony, you can. Okay. If you want to go up on the balcony, you can. Chris, would you want to be the top? Do you want to go over here from Merle? Or you can come up on the stage over here and you can watch too. If you want to take pictures or whatever, you can do that. I want to thank everyone who has helped this weekend. All of you that is helping Pastor Brady and for Pat preaching this morning, and for all of you that have just pitched in. And Paul said, "We ought to have help. I can't do this by myself." So I thank you for helping. I really do. I appreciate it very much. Anybody else want to be baptized here for a while? Just come right on.
Jesus Christ, we baptize that I'm better at trying to serve the Lord today than I was before. And it feels really good. And I'm glad to be here. It's going to be really good.
Okay.
ladies' Bible study tomorrow night.
Amen. Mm-hmm.